So I encourage you to sign up if you're at all interested. Oh, this one, new jacket, all right? Yay, so we are coming into at least the 2000s with our jacket model on that one. It was amazing what we went through to get the old ones, and through the hard work of Matt Clark, we have a new option that we're gonna fire up shortly. This is, I don't know if we still have it in here, we can show you the sample. Different material, lighter weight, it's not bunched up at the sides, so if you're tall like me, it'll actually hang on you and you won't sit on your waist. It's also going to come in men's and women's sizes, so you can have fit appropriate there. And you will be able to order online, and you will either be able to pick it up in Bellevue or it will be delivered to you. You will be able to do that at any time of the year. You won't have to go through this stuff. So hopefully this will make it a lot easier for the people that want to acquire jackets when they want to acquire them. Note that this is a new jacket option. So the old jacket, the current jacket is still an option. It's okay for crews to be in mixed jackets when these things do arrive. So if you like your current jacket, you don't want to spend the money on a new jacket, you don't have to get a new jacket. This is a new option for our jackets, but it will be very, very difficult to procure the old jackets moving forward, because I think we only have the supply that's in the trunk of Star's car right now. So there we go.
I got three mediums and two smalls and three extra.
So there, jackets.
Can you send me Star? Can you send me the staff information so I can send it out to the membership?
The jacket sizes?
Yeah, if you have, we should try to get rid of the jackets that you have.
Sold right now.
It's auction.
Cut rate, it's continued.
Good, discount.
No discounts. Charge extra, they're collector's items. Once we have this one, maybe so, but hey. Another one I was asked to throw up. So for the varsity officials, we talked about at the last meeting, we've set up a hudl account that the primary purpose was to get videos for evaluations, for the observations, because we're shifting to that this year. For I think two of our evaluations will be video. This, by putting it up here, this will get you set up with a user account that you'll be able to view the videos. So it's not just, we don't just want this to have the observers and evaluators having access to it. If you want to go up and look at your games, you'll be able to do so. You can make clips right within hudl. It's pretty easy. Download those things. Really easy to use tool for that stuff. I don't know if we came to decision, Mac, Mike, on who gets to, on what permission level we need to be able
everybody
to make.
Everyone will be an athlete. We'll be admins to do the
exchange. Okay, so yeah, you'll go on there. You will not be able to request videos from the schools, but we just set up a process about an hour ago where we'll be requesting video up like every day, essentially, from Kinko, Metro, and PSL.
Yeah, and then if there's a game on there that you want, we can probably get it. Just email me, and if there's a certain game, like maybe from the Emerald Sound or something, they have better cameras than a lot of the Kinko anyways, so we can probably get it. So.
So yeah, so link is there. QR code should get you signed up. Don't ask me after that point about approving your users. That's Mac and Mike's job, and Mr. Starr has a question.
Statement. All the Metro schools are in AHFS in all their games, Frost, JV, and Varsity. So all you have to do is be a member, pay $11 a month, you can do it for 2 months, and then cancel your membership. So anybody working, want to watch yourself work, do a Frost game, a JV game, or even Varsity games, they're there. And all Metro schools have automatic cameras in the gyms now. FYI.
And we'll get some of that on level two.
So yeah, lots of opportunity to get better, see yourself, go back and look at those plays that you wonder about the next day. All right, let's go into the updates section. Salimi, you want to go first?
So ETL has started. All right. The next tournament right now is MLK weekend. I need availability. Pretty much, we're going to now have tournaments every weekend. I have another contract that we're going to be signing soon. So we're going to have games every single weekend, probably through March, and then every other weekend till July. Yes?
Isn't this a really good opportunity for new apprentices to get experience?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I need everybody's availability.
You don't give your availability, you don't get games.
And if there's something that I need to know about, like how many games you want to work, send me an email. Just keep me posted. Other than that, please stay healthy. Please don't get injured. And I have lots of games if you're available.
Tournament still the next Wednesday, and then ETL monthly.
I'm sorry?
Tournament still the next Wednesday for payment on our pay.
Yes. So payment is still going to be the Wednesday for tournaments, the Wednesday after the tournament is completed. However, ETL is still going to fall under the once a month type deal. But for December, we're going to try to make sure everyone gets paid by the 20th of December, if we can make that happen. No promises right now, but we will try.
Can we put a tip jar at the scorer's table?
Everybody else does, right?
That's right.
No.
Good question.
You might not like what's put in that jar.
Any questions for me? All right. Thank you.
Mr. Lindsay.
Thank you. Thank you. Availability, thank you for picking up open games. It seems to be Wednesday nights, a lot of you are working college games, so Wednesday nights I have varsity officials. I've seen my emails, probably have 5 or 6 varsity openings every Wednesday. Like I said in the emails to everybody, I've got games through the 21st. For this month, and there's some tournaments in the 27th to the 30th. I have some tournament, Christmas tournament games too. So please update your availability. At least make sure that you're out 10 days. My biggest nightmare is when I release assignments and then people say, well, I got a meeting or I forgot to block out this day or blah, blah, blah. Please make sure you're available. Don't go over pending games. You're going to see the date's already blue. That game, that means I have a pending game for you. So if you try to put an availability, the one good thing about Arbiter, it tells me to the exact minute when you've updated your availability. So if I've got a pending game, I know when you put in your block. And I release assignments and you have a block for like Tuesday. Next Tuesday, the games are already assigned. That means you put it over a block. You put your block over a pending game. The app a lot of you people use is a pain in the ass because sometimes it doesn't work. I do appreciate everybody that put their game scores in, but to be honest with you, I'm going to average about 7 officials I have to call every night at 10 o'clock. Because they don't have the score in. So if I'm working with Salima, and Salima's the crew chief, I would be very smart to say, Salima, make sure you put the score into the game, okay? Because if you don't, you don't get paid. We don't get paid. So I'm not calling you or sending you a text at 10 o'clock, because that's all I have to do in my life. Okay? You guys are lucky I'm a night person. Because if I was a person who went to bed at 7 or 8 o'clock at night, it would be a pain in the ass to try to do it the next day. So please remember after your game, if you're the crew chief, and it's pretty easy because it says crew chief, just put the score in, okay? Just do it. But I would remind my crew chief to make sure they do it so I get paid within 72 hours. It's always a surprise to officials. never worried about pay, but if they're not paid within 72 hours, they send me an email. Or if there's not a travel on that. Everything is updated when the score gets in there. So if you don't have the travel in there, there's a glitch in the system, so the $2 increase wasn't put in. But everybody that got paid the right amount, because I have to check all the games. So if I have 25 games, I have to go in there and make sure that it's the signer has to do a lot more with this system so you can get paid within 72 hours, which is a great thing. But just take care of your responsibility. Some of you are on the will never be a crew chief list. It has nothing to do with you're ranked higher than somebody else. You know, it doesn't make any sense because you can't get the scores in, so I've got a list of people that won't be crew chiefs. It doesn't mean, crew chief does not mean that you're the top ranked official, okay? Because we know we get on the court, we're going to know who the best official is. Take over the game if you need to take over the game, okay? Just because you're the crew, just because you're not the crew chief doesn't mean you can just, hey, it's not my responsibility and stuff like that. We've got to follow the rules, make sure that we have the book taken care of on time. That's the responsibility of the crew. Crew chief might have been over there, but we need to make sure that we're taking the responsibility. And if you're not the crew chief and something happens to the game, don't just throw up your hands and say, well, I'm not the crew chief. Because when I get emails from schools, they're not saying that this person, that person, they're saying the crew didn't do this. And I sent a few of them to Mike. He gets to respond to this stuff because he volunteered to be president. So. If you have issues with schools, please make sure you send me an email so I know that the athletic directors I'll contact right away. We want to make sure we're treated right. So if there's a problem with that. The sportsmanship survey thing that we do, that's an optional thing. And the system's been messed up because some people are getting it, you know, 2 o'clock in the afternoon. The game isn't until 7 o'clock at night, which is like, you know. And it's not, you're not rating your partner. It's on the game. And the ones and the fives are the only ones that I receive. You know, if somebody treats you really well, then you need to send that in. If there's an issue like that, send it in. And then I'll get those emails too, if it's a 1 or a 5. But if somebody, if it's a normal game, don't give somebody a 5. You don't need to do that. But if it's exceptional, then we want to get it. Or if it's a problem, we want to do that. And the reason we're doing this is because if we have problems with schools, if we have problems with sportsmanship, you can't say your officials are treated this way unless we have some documentation, and that's why this whole thing started. But it is an optional thing. We hope you would do it, especially if it's a 1 or 5. Registered. If you're registered, you can work middle school, afternoon games. You're registered. Certified, you can work 9th grade and above. So, some of the apprentices that aren't certified, we want you to get certified because on Friday, especially Saturday, there aren't middle school games. And we need you to work as much as possible. Evaluation started last week, so they're just in the process. We probably have maybe 30 officials that got at least one evaluation. If you don't have availability, there's going to be a point where you're going to have to decide, I want to get evaluated on the girls' side or the boys' side. If you give me no availability in December, don't expect that in January I'm going to be able to get you 8 observations, 4 on the boys and 4 on the girls. So there will be a time when I'm going to come to you and say, you know, you're not available in December. And there's people in this room that haven't worked a single game. I'm glad you come to the meetings. You look good and stuff like that. It's nice to see you. But, you know, if you're not on the freaking court, I mean, I don't know. But sooner or later, you're going to have to make a decision because I'm not going to be able to get you evaluations in January. So you have to decide if you want on the girls or boys. So if you just want to work girls' games, or work boys' games, or don't mind working stat games, that's fine. We want you on the court. But there will be a time when you're going to have to make a decision on where you want to get evaluated. because I can't get you the evaluations in January. Especially with the holiday tournaments, that's a good time to get evaluations. I want to make sure everybody has at least one or two evaluations by the end of the year. That's the goal. But if you give me no availability, I mean, you know, I can give you an evaluation. It probably won't be very good. But that's up to you. But we need everybody out there. Some of you are working every day, multiple games. You guys are just rock stars. People that aren't working are not rock stars. Don't get hurt. They're rocks. that came from him. I like that. You know, we had one person got hurt, and then the varsity officials went last night, and I told them, you guys decide who you want to move on the varsity game. We want to get every varsity game with three officials. Every game that we service, that is our. Some schools, I question if they really need three officials, but that's not my job to question it. So I'm trying to get three officials on every single game that we have. But if you have a game and there's a JV official, two JV officials, and you want X to work the game with you, then you say, hey, we need you to work the varsity game. Please step up. We didn't have a problem last time, but we got a guy hurt. It's 3:45 game. He couldn't go at 7, so the two officials decide this person is going to work it. Don't, if you're not selected, don't feel bad or something like that. We're not trying to hurt anybody's feelings. We need to cover the games. But I appreciate you responding to open games. I'll be sending out emails this week for open games because I have lots of open games. Thank you.
One thing, I looked at my calendar while John was talking, and those Christmas tournament games, 27th, 28th, 29th, those are weekdays, and these tournaments typically have afternoon games. So if you're, you know, taking time off over the holidays, or your work schedule is such that you may always have, you know, like I have it blocked through 4:30 every weekday of the month for work, but I'm taking time off that week, so clear the block so John can see your availability on those days for those afternoon games.
And some of you need to make a doctor appointment or a dentist appointment at a gym at 3:30 this season. You know, I've talked to most of your family members, and they want you to work more games. And I know you hate your job. Okay? I know you hate your boss and your coworkers, so you need to take an afternoon off and work your game.
All right, so let's move on. You got more? Are we good? Let's move on to, we'll just have the committee member updates. I know, Tony, you wanted time for E&G. Or Tony Ford. There, yeah.
Thank you, Tony. So, once again, I'll reiterate, if you have a problem during a game or a member, just reach out to me. And if you're not a good communication, reach out to somebody that can communicate with you. Okay? I try to resolve the issue before it gets into paperwork. So maybe we can come to an agreement or a resolution. But the most important thing is respect all parts of the game. Most important, respect us. We have to work together. So you don't mean you have to like somebody? Do the best you can. Call me, call Mike, call Brian. Hey, I had a problem. Vent to us, we'll try to figure it out. Okay? Don't take it out at the game, or don't take it out in the parking lot, don't take it out at the bar. Right? So just try to respect each other, and I do my best, and we do our best to get back with you guys. Okay? Especially with coaches and players and stuff like that. You know, we're not going to be perfect, but we're going to try to fix the problems as well as we can. I think our board does pretty good at communicating with us and the memberships, and, you know, just reach out to one of us if you're not a good communicator so we can resolve the issue. So I don't have to do a lot of paperwork. That's the most important thing. Okay, thanks guys. Have fun.
All right, Mr. Thornley, you were next up.
to pick first. I got a bag and two envelopes.
Rigged.
What, Gary?
Homage. Gary Schoen.
We have Gary's, Gary's.
And Payton.
Who gets the old shoes?
Who gets the used shoes?
Ramaj, Gary, Schoen, what do you got?
All Gary's.
They're going one very dirty, though.
Payton is third. Gary, what do you got? Novel or bag?
You should just got one last time.
Payton,
used
shoes.
That's me.
Oh, pick it.
Santa Star.
All right, is Marcy here? Marcy? I haven't met Marcy. I want to be good. Anything you guys hear negative in this meeting about people not doing something? Probably doesn't apply to you people. Apply to people who aren't here. I just want you guys to know that, so let your friends know that we're talking about them. Most everybody that's here, too, has their MSA done. There's only like a handful of people that don't. They're not here, so I'm talking to them through about 25,000 emails. I'm not talking to you. You guys are great. Makeup meetings. The requirements, you have to do 3 meetings. 2 of those meetings have to come here and see me and hear my music. The third one, you can substitute. You can go to the, you could have gone to the varsity meeting. You can go to another state meeting. Associates like Tacoma, Snohomish, or something. Or you could be working a game as one of those. Or you could do one of our videos online. But you still have to come to 2 in-person meetings. If you don't, there's a penalty. You are penalty of $25 for each one you miss. And you're a member not in good standing, which means you can't work games. If you have any questions about that, see me personally, and we'll take care of that. We talked about the jackets. That. One final thing is, I have some information up here. Will you drive that for me and go down to the little board policies? Keep going. Oh, too far. Show more.
Jeez.
Okay, the master roster. Roster. That's basically that thing you sign. You don't have to bring it up. Oh. That's what you sign into. If you ever had a game, you might want to print this off so you know who a person is and what they are. What level they're on, that's kind of cool. Go back up, and could you go to the other page, all the way to the top? I'm a teacher, so this is visual for the visual learners. You go to the menu and go to members only. Let's go to members. There you go, good work.
I'm already in members only.
Okay, go to members login.
I don't want to log in again.
You don't have to log in, you shouldn't.
You never know with this thing. Yeah, I'm clicking on it, you can say, oh, there we go.
Oh,
we just want to go to the PNBOA.
You were there. Okay, menu. I need to see that menu.
Yeah, you
slide down.
Move
the slider.
Move down. Well, I don't know.
Okay, there's board history there. That's who's on the board, who's been there. We have committees.
Recognition.
Oh, no, it's not there. Go back. Anyway, I'm trying to. I know where it's at. Sorry, go back.
To which back?
To the other one.
The logged in state?
There you go. Sorry.
No, I just want to make sure.
It's on the, not the technical, that one. It's keep going down. It should say technical somewhere in there. Does anybody see it?
Technical power?
Technical incidents?
Yeah, that one. Okay, board members get information on everybody every time there's a report filled out about technicals. You guys don't get that information. We've been in the season a couple weeks now. There's already been 38. I put it up there. I don't put the schools. I don't put the names. I just put what the incident is in case you're curious. That's all I just wanted to share with you. That information is there. It has everything that happens. Doesn't have names in case some name or school gets snuck in there. But in case you're interested, 38 already this year. So you can see the kinds of things that are going on. I like to share. That's
what about pitchers and arbiters?
Yeah. Pitchers and arbiters, help you get glass, you got them in there. It helps out. Anything else, John, that I didn't do my report?
No, we just need people that go in there and get their picture in.
It's pretty simple. I've done it for a couple of people. If you send me a picture, I'll do it for you. If you can't do it. I've also been updating the years because somebody asked me, Peyton asked me, I believe, who wants to know who he's working with, how long you've been in the association. So I've been updating those. If you can't do it, I have to do it, so I think I'm up to the E's already.
Ding, nice.
Thank you very much.
Full service membership. All right, anybody else on the board have something that you wanted to update on recruiting? Probably we need a word from you. Let's go Moz or Saito, who you got? Perfect.
So we need more officials. End of story. If you can bring somebody in that means there's probably 5-10 games, you don't have to work. So bring somebody in and do me a favor. I follow up, but if you bring somebody in, you follow up with them too and make sure they come to the class. Okay? That really helps us. We don't have to chase down leads. Okay? Oh, and I've got cards, and I usually hand them out when somebody doesn't like the call I make, so some of you will need a lot more than this. grab them. They do help.
Just one last one. The best recruiters are the people in here.
Right.
Take care of your partner, because the person you recommend, that's the best person that's going to get the recruiter. Retention and recruitment are tie game. How are we treating the partners? How are we making them feel? It's not what we say, it's how they feel when we need that. Yes, and that's the most important thing. And it's real critical.
Now, what you can do is ask yourself, what can I do to make this better? That is a big help for retention.
Randy, anything? Front tie.
Apprentice, you guys are working out there. Just keep on trying. Don't get injured. Open your availability.
Be nice to the apprentices. Watch a game. Only pick. You don't need to pick out like 10 things they did wrong. Pick out things that are important, and make sure you end the conversation with a positive. We want them to come back. We want them to work. Do not run off the apprentices. I hear about it. It's very irritating. You're on that irritating list.
No crew chief list. Irritating list.
There is a list.
There's the double secret list.
There's a list. And the people that work a lot and help out all the time, you're on a special list too. And it's usually the people in this room, because the people that don't care aren't here. Cool.
Anybody else on the board?
Yes.
Real quick, varsity officials, I have forms, and varsity officials, please, please, please evaluate the JV officials. Even if you're working with them, you can evaluate them. If you want forms, you come over here. I'm not bringing them to you. What's up?
So remember, if I'm working a varsity game and that official I'm working with is on the girls list or not on the varsity list, you can do an evaluation on that.
Absolutely.
Does everybody understand that? So I'm working with the one official that's on the girls list and the JV, and it's a boys varsity game, you can evaluate. The same thing on the other side. If you work in a girls game, you can do an evaluation on that partner that goes into this number, because there's a lot of officials that are working double headers, and they might not be on the varsity list for one. So please do those evaluations too.
If we end up with a night where somehow we're not working a JV game, is there a way for us to find out who is working the JV game?
So nice question, but not
very. Nope.
Very.
Officials on the JV game before, so we don't show up and watch the JV game, we can't evaluate.
You need to be there early, Mary. Thank you. Arvin does not give that option, okay? We're not doing it. No.
I think it's the exact same question, but Sean's joking about it, but I'm not going to show up 2 hours early to find out either there's no JV game or that both officials are varsity. So I know we're kidding around. But
yeah, but if you're working at 7 o'clock, 7:15, 7:30, there is a JV game ahead of it.
Or it wasn't on Wednesday, John.
What?
It wasn't on Wednesday at ASAC Capital.
Yeah. Well, they just dropped their JV program on Monday. Okay, right.
So I showed up 2 hours early, left work early to go to the game, and then I'm sitting around not doing anything.
Because remember, you only have to do two quarters. It's not the whole game. Two quarters is
the whole game. You shouldn't have been there 2 hours before the game, but because you only have to do the second half of the game or the second quarter. But incidents like that will happen, but I guarantee if you go through the whole year, there will only be one or two instances when you have that, when there's not a JV program.
My question is, why is it with soccer that arbiter allows you to see every game and every official? Basketball doesn't.
Basketball doesn't. I mean, we already addressed this issue before. We don't do that, so... That's fine.
Part of it is because then people start worrying too much about who's working what game and why am I not working this game, and it just becomes, it actually becomes kind of an ego thing, which is one of the things I was going to mention. But the other thing I would say is if you are working the JV game ahead of the varsity game, let your partners know that, hey, by the way, I'm working the, you know, me and Brian are working the JV game ahead of the varsity game, so, you know, you don't need to show up early to evaluate. So do that, at least that kind of communication with your partners, because I don't think John normally will have two varsity officials working a JV game and then a whole new set of varsity officials working the varsity game.
Right, just communicate with your partner.
Right, and you can go to the league websites, too, and check the schedules and just see if there's a JV game.
Gary?
Yes, how about, you know, ever thought about doing these evals via the games on video? Someone said these freshman JV games are on video. Well, why can't we watch those games and give an observation at home?
Because we're not doing that yet, that's why.
It's a good idea, though.
It's not a bad idea.
Yeah, but the only problem that is you might do evaluations on somebody that you think should be on the varsity list, and you're not in the gym. So if you have the varsity game and the game's on before, it can be good. But the point of it is that why are people doing it, and that's...
So I'm going to take one. I'm sorry, I don't want to cut. I mean, get one more, but I want to... We got games, and I was truly an innocuous question. I was trying to find out. I didn't want to start a discussion right now. So why don't you ask your question, comment?
Yeah, you know, a couple of us already downloaded that app where you talked about the videos, and it's really kind of weird. You're registering as an athlete. How do you actually find the videos? Because, you know, I'm on the thing now.
Okay, so, I think we
you
can, we, it's, yeah, I think, so let me, like, giving a huddle class is probably, not. It's really hard to do on the spot. I'll address a couple things. Huddle is not designed for officials to watch video, right? Huddle is designed for teams. We are essentially a team in there, and consider us all as referee athletes, right? And you will have games that are accessible to the team. Those games will be sucked in by a handful of people that are taking on the responsibility to pull the games in, the varsity games at least. My recommendation is after we get through like December and we actually get this thing working, that maybe Mac and Mike, you figure out if there how there is a way to start reaching in to request the Frosh and JV stuff, like select ones and getting them pulled in. Is that fair?
Yes. If you want a particular game, like if you want a freshman or a JV game, reach out to us and we can probably, if they record it. They don't always record their games. Varsity games, we're trying to, it's up to the coaches. We got to send a request, they send it to us, we put it in the huddle, then you can go on and watch. But as far as the lower level games, we do not request them. I actually tell them, we don't want any freshman or JV games. We're not doing that. But if you want them, reach out to us and we will try to get that.
Could you, if you have any tips that you can just jot down, you know, a few bullet points on how to use it or whatever.
I'll put a video together.
Okay.
Okay,
so we got three things. We've had a brief discussion on why or why not we can't see games. It's heard. Mike was taking copious notes on that stuff. We're going to work on, you know, if right now we get this thing up and running, if you're working a Frosh or JV game and want the video requested, work with Mike or Mac to make that request. And Mac, in short order, we'll create a video, kind of quick video, how-to explainer on how to use hudl, and we can get it on the PNBOA channel, we'll get Star, whoever, to get it posted on the website stuff, so we have that access to those things. Cool? And if there's any more feedback on those topics, I'd say, I'm not trying to shut down that part of it, I just want to keep this thing moving, and like I said, most everybody's got games, so.
Send questions to me and Mac.
Cool. All right. Any other committee stuff? Only one thing that popped in my head on the school stuff is if you guys end up at Edmonds Woodway for a varsity home game, they have great uniforms. And I'm just telling you this right now is that they will bring you a waiver from WIA at some point. So don't run back in the locker room to look at the rule book and stuff like that. It's there. It's coming. They have it at the table to wear their grades for their home. Just sharing. What's that? Okay. With that, we'll move on to Mike's session here. And you can forward and back with that.
Which way?
The right one moves it forward.
And if you okay. Right,
yeah.
All right.
All right, so I know some of you have seen this little presentation that I do for traveling, but I see a lot of faces who maybe haven't. So those who have seen it, you know, bear with me, and hopefully everybody gets something out of this little presentation here. All right, traveling is illegal versus legal movement in the high school game. High school is not about steps. High school is all about pivot foot in it being established. If you've got your rule book, what I'm going over is rule 4-44, which is traveling. Okay? There are two basic definitions. First is illegal foot movement while you're holding the ball. And the second is touching the floor with any part of the body other than the hand or the foot while holding the ball. Very key point. All right. What makes traveling hard is that we have to do a bunch of processing real quickly. The first thing we have to determine is the player holding the ball, you know, caught a pass, got a rebound, or a player has ended their dribble and is now holding the ball. Those are usually the three ways that you get to be holding the ball. The next thing you have to judge is the position of the feet when they are holding the ball initially. Then you have to determine the pivot foot. Then you have to determine, have they done a jump stop? And the jump stop as defined in Rule 4-44 versus what coaches try to teach their players what a jump stop is. And then, has the player violated the restrictions on the pivot foot? Okay, those are the main steps of the determining legal and illegal foot movement. And then the next thing you have to determine on the other side is if the player falls to the floor, were they holding the ball before or after they landed on the floor? Okay, because if they fall or are holding the ball before they fall on the floor, that's traveling. If they gain control of the ball after on the floor, then we've got a whole different animal. Any questions so far? Perfect. All right. Is the player holding the ball or has ended the dribble? What is holding the ball? This is holding the ball. This is holding the ball. Okay? You can hold the ball with one hand. You can hold the ball with two hands. Okay? Pretty simple, right? This is not holding the ball. Pretty simple. We're not holding it. It's on the floor. And then we have to know when the dribble has ended. It's important to know when the dribble has ended for both calling, traveling, and continuous motion. That was just a little side thing on it. Right? So if we're dribbling the ball, once we do this, we've ended our dribble and are now holding the ball. If we do this, we've ended the dribble, now holding the ball. Right? Any questions? All right, determine the position of the feet. So I need my able assistant, and I just need somebody. Sorry, can you pass him the ball when I need it? All right, come on up here. I need you behind here. Turn around.
Okay. Now pull my shorts up.
Well, that's why I chose my foot.
All right, pull the shorts up. There
we go. All right, so if you think about it, the feet can only be in one of three positions when you get the ball. Toss the ball. Both feet down, toss it back. Both feet up. Or toss it back. One foot down, one foot up. Those are three positions the balls can be when you pull that top thing over my elbows.
There. Oh my God.
Yeah. Boy, perfect. Okay. So when both feet are off the floor and he catches the ball, he can both feet, so the first foot that comes down, when the next foot comes down, this was the pivot foot. This foot has to touch for it to be the pivot foot. If he catches the ball, go ahead and toss it back. If he catches the ball with both feet down, the first foot lifted, this is the pivot foot. Okay? And if he catches the ball with one foot down and one foot up, when he puts this foot down, this is now the pivot foot. Okay? Go ahead and toss the ball back. Now we have something called the jump stop. The jump stop is jumping off of one foot and landing on both feet simultaneously. So if he catches the ball and he puts one foot down, he can jump off that foot and has to land like this. Right? Can he pivot from here?
No.
Once he starts doing that, he has traveled. You can do the same thing, tossing the ball back. If you have one foot down when you are holding the ball, again, you can jump off that foot, land on both feet simultaneously. Can't pivot after that as well. Now, go ahead and toss in the ball. Now, if I jump off that foot, and we land, what do we have?
Travel.
The ball, the feet did not land simultaneously. Now I'm not that good of an official tossing the ball back. To where, especially at real time speed, tossing the ball, and he jumps off that foot. Are we good enough to call that a travel?
No.
I'm not. Okay. What I want to get is the obvious, toss it back, jump off the one foot, easy travel. We need to get that every time.
This is the biggest one, I guess, is that. What do we got there?
Say what?
I was the guy, Gerbil's ball.
That's fine. That's fucking good. Because he did you. In fact, thanks, man. Thanks,
that was really great.
Right, so what Star just demonstrated was a piece that we have to determine. How many figured that Star got the ball when both feet were in the air on that play? That's what I have. Right. He's gathered with both feet in the air, and he landed on both feet simultaneously. So that means either foot could be the pivot foot. Let's see what I have over here.
Still on the ground.
What's that?
Gathers well, but still on the ground, and then he jumps in simultaneously.
Well, if he jumps off of the 1 foot and ends his dribble holding the ball and lands on both feet simultaneously, that's a legal play. He just can't pivot from there because he jumped off of 1 foot and landed on both feet simultaneously. Right, so this is just what I was talking about. You know, the key is don't overcomplicate it. The feet can only be in one of three positions when they're holding the ball. All right, so we were determining the pivot foot there, both feet on the floor, first foot lifted. Actually, that should be first foot lifted and then it touches. That's when it becomes the pivot foot. If both feet are off the floor, land simultaneously, either foot could be the pivot foot. 1 foot lands first, that foot is now the pivot foot. And you can do that jump stop that we talked about. And from both of those positions where you have 1 foot on the floor, you can jump and land on both feet simultaneously. And this is where I was talking about. Coaches call a jump stop, they define it differently than we do. When we talk about a jump stop, we are talking about jumping off of 1 foot and landing on both feet simultaneously. That is our jump stop by rule. And then it can only occur if a player lands on 1 foot or is on 1 foot holding the ball. And we talked about that, land on both feet simultaneously. And like everybody said, we cannot pivot. We aren't always good at that one, are we? But we're getting better because we're getting trained on the traveling stuff. So we need to realize that they go from here to here, they can't do this, traveling. Todd actually had a good call on that one last night in our game. But that's exactly what happened. The player did the jump stop and then started pivoting and traveling. That'll work from the bench. Yes, sir.
On that jump stop, though, can they lift the foot up to go, say, do a layup or pass?
Absolutely.
If they can, they just can't put it
down. They just can't put it back down. Exactly. They can always, and I think that's on here too, once the pivot foot is established, it can't be lifted and returned to the floor. That's the basics of traveling right there. In high school, you can't pick up the pivot foot and put it on the floor. It can't be lifted prior to the start of the dribble. It cannot be lifted. So if I'm doing this, and then I go like this, that is also a travel, because he lifted the pivot foot before he released the ball on the dribble. But it can be lifted, the player releases the ball for a pass or a try. So if I do this, and I'm doing this, and I look at Star, I'm good, okay? Or I do this, and then I go up like that, I'm also good. So they can lift the pivot foot up for a pass or a try, but they can't lift it prior to the start of the dribble. Prior to the release of the ball for a dribble.
What if you muff it at that point?
Fumble it?
Yeah.
Fumble it? You can always recover your own fumble.
Yeah, that's important.
Right, and the pivot foot can't be dragged. Right, that's illegal movement. Yes, sir.
So I got stuck with this. Players on the ground.
Hold up. We're going to get to that. Okay, so that's all the restrictions about the pivot foot. Any questions about pivot foot?
Can you show us what the coaches are teaching? You mentioned it a couple times.
Well, coaches call the jump stop anything where the player gathers the ball at any point and then lands on both feet. That's what they usually call a jump stop. Would you guys agree with that?
Yeah.
Does that answer it? Question, Mike?
Common. What we're seeing mostly with pivot foot replant is when they back up behind the 3-point arc and they'll pivot and then step back beyond the three and take a 3-point shot. We're not calling that.
Until last night I called it a couple of times.
He called it last
night. So that whole hardened step back It's just actually a travel going backwards as opposed to toward the basket. So you'll see people end their dribble and then they go. That's a travel. In high school,
Steph
that's
Curry
a travel.
Does that every night.
What's that? Exactly.
That's,
or hard.
That's what the guy said last night.
I said Steph Curry does it all the time. Oh, that's funny. That's funny. But right, so, you know, that's all part of the determining traveling is, you know, knowing what that pivot foot is on the play. And they can do the step back. They just need to land with both feet simultaneously. And again, we're not going to cut hairs. We want to make sure we get that's the easy travel to get. This one where it's like, I'm not so sure I'm good enough to know that this foot actually hit just before this foot. I'm not that good. Yeah, Don.
How about when they catch the ball on the floor and reposition yourself for the shot?
Well, by rule, that's a travel, and we see that quite a bit. Or the little bunny hop, you know.
They get
the ball, and then they do that. Again, it's determining, were they holding the ball when they went from here to here? And usually it's when they're catching a pass. Or did they catch the pass after they started their little bunny hop? Because then both feet are in the air, and they can make a normal landing. But right, the whole reposition the feet, you know, to get the shot off. And the other one that we see a lot too is they do, and then they split their feet before they take off.
Right.
So again, all those are a kind of traveling.
They might have a long pass or a lay-in. The kid jumps up, catches the ball, comes in on 1 foot, and takes two and lays it in. It looks like a basketball play, but by rule, it's a travel. So I guess you got to travel.
That's a travel.
A lot of times, it looks like a great normal basketball play. Or the guy dunks the ball. The crowd goes crazy. You come in here and wave it off and say travel. All of a sudden,
do you care? Do you care that the fans are ignorant and don't know that it's a travel? Well, that's the truth. I know that there are people out here who don't like to make tough calls because we get yelled at. So that's just, you know, what we need is to have crew consistency on it. You know, we don't want one person calling the step back, and then we have a play at the other end, and the other official sees the same step back, and they're not willing to make the call. We, as a crew, need to be on the same page. Does that hurry up, Matt? Okay. All right. They talk about in the case book about some of these plays considering falling to the floor. Remember, they can gain control of the ball while on the floor, not while in the air before they get to the floor. So they get the rebound and they fall to the ground. That's a travel, right? They may slide or roll holding the ball if the movement is caused by momentum. So they've got that loose ball on the floor and they're diving for it and they gain control and their momentum causes them to slide 10 feet. What is everybody screaming? Traveling. No, they can slide as far as their momentum takes and be legal, I should say, as long as it's their momentum that caused them to do it. Well, the whole roll is momentum again. If they're rolling to try to get away from somebody, that's a travel. Once they go from back to, there's no pivot, cheeks, okay? Then say cheeks. If they roll to get away from somebody, different than if they're just trying to keep away, you know, and they're twisting their body, but if they physically roll to another position, then we have a travel.
If they switch cheeks.
Oh, hold on.
You want to come demonstrate it?
Joe first.
Some words about, what are words that you have in your mind about getting up? I mean, obviously.
Hold on a second, because that's okay. my next one. Dale.
Explain number two there. Is that saying that a player diving in the air, grabbing the ball, and landing on the floor is a travel?
Yeah, so if they gain control of the ball while they're in the air and they gain control of it and land, that is a travel.
Like a rebound service.
Right.
Yeah, but Mike, I think what you're testing, if you go for a rebound, you come on your feet, you fall down. Versus if you dive for the ball and catch it and land on your
that is a travel because you're going to the ground while holding the ball. You need to gain control of the ball while you're already on the ground. I know you're making a funny look, but that's how I would.
So your player's been aggressive, he's diving for the ball, he or she, and she gains control while she's in the air, she's in the air, and lands on the floor, that's a travel.
That is a travel.
That's taken away from the aggressiveness. That's a bad thing.
Well, I hear you. I would ask Federation to change it then. But that's not the way the rule reads right now. Hold on, I had another question back there.
Okay, so if you mentioned that as long as it's not momentum, if they turn away when they're on the floor, you know, trying to.
They change position.
Right, that's okay, correct?
No, they can't change position. They can twist to like no, I don't want you on. So if I'm on the floor and I've got the ball and I'm kind of doing this to try to keep people away, that's fine. But once I go like this, that's a travel. Or oh, hold on. Yes.
If you're on your stomach and you roll over, you go more good, you slide down the corners.
Right, and I got to here, and, roll over, travel.
That's a job.
Travel. You've got to either pass the ball.
Said you can roll.
Oh, so if your momentum, so you go for it and your momentum caused you to roll with it? That would be, again, it's a judgment call on whether you think they're rolling from momentum or are they rolling to get away from a play. I know, I feel awkward now. A pivot belly. Yes, yes, sir.
So if they're catching the ball, but there's a slippery spot on the floor and it happens to a greasy spot, slippery spot, and they're sliding, you know, are you going to call a travel then, or if you know, hey, because of the slippery spots, are you going to address that separately?
It's, well, I'm kind of confused. What's.
It's a travel, and then you get a towel and clean it up.
Right. Again, it's all about momentum. Did momentum cause them to slide? Yeah, Don.
On their back, what can they do on their back?
Oh, hold on. Let me see if I can have it on there. Okay. So if they're on their back, they can sit up. They're allowed to sit up. They can actually, if they're sitting up and they move their feet to sit up, remember there's no pivot foot at this time. So we don't worry about what the feet are doing. It's pivot cheeks.
Thank you.
Pivot cheeks. Right? So they can sit up to pass the ball. They can shoot if they want. Or if they have a dribble still, if they haven't dribbled, they can start a dribble. Let's see if I have that skill. Absolutely, they can call a timeout. Great point, Don.
Mike. Can I follow up on that point about the guy diving to the floor?
Sure.
So if you, go up for a rebound, you're in the air, and you come down, you beat the floor, and you fall.
Yep.
That's a trap.
That's a trap.
Did you establish a pivot?
No.
No.
Well,
it has nothing to do with pivot. There's no pivot foot involved right now.
So that's the fall down rule. Okay.
Right.
But where in the, I'm trying to go to the case book right now. Where in the case book does it say that if I dive in air and I establish possession before my body hits the floor and then I hit the floor and slide, that's not momentum?
It doesn't say that in the book. It says going to the floor while holding the ball is a travel.
I would just pause it. I'm not going to be that good.
Okay.
Well, I'm calling it or falling to the floor.
what I would hope is that we're not bringing in a college interpretation into what we have.
Well, that's what I'm asking. I'm not understanding what that.
Because they didn't want to differentiate whether the person caught the ball while in the air or whatever. They're just saying if you have a hold of the ball and you touch the floor with anything but the feet or the hands, it's a travel.
Mike, on that rebound, you
gather the ball, you're going to fall down. You have the presence of mind to let the ball go, and you can regather on the court. That's a legal basketball.
Absolutely, because you didn't hit the ground while holding the ball.
Yes, and many times referees, when they see a player on the court, automatically 85% of referees have got to travel.
You've got a stat. You've got that stat.
Yes, maybe 90.
If there's a question, don't blow your whistle.
Right. If that is such a great point. If you can't right. explain to the coach why it was a travel, do not call it. That's my biggest suggestion when it comes to travel.
Let me
finish mine. See if that does it. And then on the flip side, if you call a travel, be able to tell the coach what they did wrong. What did my player do wrong? Coach, they lifted the pivot foot up before they started their dribble. Or coach, they replanted their pivot foot. Or, what we shouldn't say is, coach, they took too many steps. That is not a rule-based answer. Whenever we need to communicate with these coaches, we should be giving them rule-based answers. Okay, go ahead, Mitch.
Yeah, so anytime we put air into the game, put a whistle in the game, we have to be sure. What's the typical average score of a high school basketball game? 60? Each possession, each team gets about that many possessions in a basketball game. So if we're putting stuff into the game that we can't explain, we're taking away possessions, we're taking away points.
Or if you're at the Garfield Eastside Catholic game, it's 34-35, and that was a crazy score. All right, I mean, very important. Anytime we put air in the whistle, we need to be able to explain to a coach, if they ask, what my player do wrong.
And if it's unclear, I think it's easier to say to the coach, if it's close, maybe I missed it, versus being wrong and then trying to die on that hill.
Right. Don't lie.
I like that.
Don't lie to the coach. Just be honest. And sometimes we can tell them, maybe just once a game, coach, I may have missed that one. When I was first coming up, I was told if it looks funny, it must be traveling. That is not true at all. Looking funny doesn't make it traveling. A player can't travel if they're not holding the ball or don't have control of the ball. They can't travel if they're dribbling the ball. Can't travel. A player can always recover their fumble. Always. If they've been dribbling, they end a dribble and they fumble it, they can go get the ball. They can't start another dribble, but they can always go recover their own fumble. And then a player can always rebound their own try, even if it's an air ball. How many times do we hear, travel, they can't catch their own try? And then to Mitch's point right there, if you blow your whistle, we have to be right. We have to be sure, because we're stopping the game. Now everybody's looking at you. So be sure, be confident when you blow your whistle on a call.
Mike, also, when you're out of bounds, there's never traveling.
Correct.
If a player runs out of his space, don't tweet and call travel. That's not a good look. It's a violation of the thrower.
Right. It's just boop, and you just point to the throw-in spot. They violated the throw-in. But they can do this. They can go back while holding the ball on the throw-in. Yes, Stephen.
So if a player intentionally realizes he's just stuck, he intentionally fumbles the ball to recover it,
intentionally fumbles. I'd have to see it. Well, now if they throw it down, that's different than fumbling, because now that's considered a dribble. So
it's hard to describe, but I've seen a player that I can tell won't want to do his head thing.
You're a mind reader. All right. All right, and then the spin move real quick. It's usually done by a player obviously making a move to the basket. It's a pivoting motion as opposed to a stepping motion, and it becomes a travel when the pivot foot is replanted. Let's see. Are my videos on there?
It should be, yeah. Keep going.
Okay. Some quick takeaways. We have to process and rather quickly those five things, that fast. Sometimes that fast, right? And you have to go through this process every time from catch to release of the ball. Every time. And then, if you blow your whistle, you have to be right. All right, so let's see if these are going to work. Do I just have to press this?
No, if you try it, if not,
okay, no, okay, perfect.
I'll go back.
This one you want?
No, the previous one.
Okay, I will.
Very obvious travel. He ended the dribble, holding the ball, spun around, and then replanted the pivot foot. We should be able to get this one every time.
You want to watch it through or go to the next one?
Yeah, go to the next one. Any questions about that one? That was pretty easy. Next one, there we go. Right, same kind of move. He gathered the ball right there with his right foot on the floor, came around, obviously replanted it, went up.
You can tell when he gathered?
Yeah. Yeah, especially on the second one where he was coming at you. Let's see if you can pause it.
It's hard to see it.
I'm not that good.
Yeah. Yeah, it looks like he had gathered it when he was kind of like right in here and came around.
Mike, do you have words that you use in your mind for the spin move? What are you thinking about?
No. The words in my mind when I'm looking at a spin move is it an obvious travel? Is it an obvious, they've got the ball here, they're doing this, and then they go up like that. That's what's processing in my mind. I don't want to try to do I gotcha. I want it to be when they look at this film, they would say, oh yeah, that was a trap. Right. Okay, go to the next one.
Mike.
Yes, ma'am.
I think the real question there is like words to explain it to the coach.
I just tell them, coach.
How is that a travel?
Coach, he replanted his pivot foot. And if you can even say, Coach, the right foot was his pivot foot, he spun on his left foot and replanted the right foot, that's even more.
Remember, 3 seconds with the coach, because yes, they're going to ask you another follow-up question. So you give them 3 seconds, talk to them, and go.
Right, and you don't, it's not a discussion. It's like, Coach, you asked me the question, I gave you the answer, we're moving on.
Especially when Roper's coaching.
Again, that's another one of those obvious ones that we should get.
Metro Junior High.
Left foot was the pivot foot. They stepped with their right foot and then went back with their left foot.
I don't ask questions, John.
Okay.
I just let them know what's
what's right.
All right. Any questions about that one? Go ahead, next one. I think this is the last one. That one's a little bit tougher.
Yeah.
That might be one that we might not get in first time, real time. But when we see it in slow motion, you'll go, oh yeah. So she actually landed with her right foot, then her left foot landed, and then she spun around and replanted the right foot. But that one, let me finish. That one's tough because in slow motion or in regular speed, I'm not sure I'd be able to determine that the right foot landed before the left foot. It looked like it happened so quick in real time, I might not get it. Go ahead, Benton.
So my question for you on this one is, who's official, which official has called, should make this call?
That's a great question. Usually, in this case, probably the C Or the trail could as well, because they've got that look in. I think travel calls from the outside usually are our best calls. You know, because the lead, they're looking knees to shoulders usually for contact and stuff like that. And if we have a double whistle, if we've got a lead who does catch a travel at the same time that the trail has it, I like the trail to take it. Right? Yes?
Now, look at that so far. She lands on both players.
Her right foot? Well, it looked like she landed on the floor. No, she didn't land on the floor. It would not be a pivot foot.
If she had just went and actually released a shot before she put her right foot down, it's not a throw.
Correct. Remember, they can lift. So on that spin move, if they get the ball here, do this, and then are able to release it before they replant it, that's a good play. So don't anticipate the spin move is going to be a travel. I've seen that a few times where the officials are blowing the whistle before the travel has actually happened. So don't anticipate.
Same thing on a carry. You do a big carry, and then you catch the ball.